Good morning. It's good to be back. I hope you had a good week, and I hope you are ready to praise our Lord together. But before we do that, I want to encourage you to say hi to each other, to give a hug, a virtual hug, or whatever you want to say. And it's good to be here together and praise our Lord. I want to encourage you this morning to join me in asking our God to open our eyes so we can see Him. To open our eyes so we can see His glory, we can see His power, we can see His splendor and His majesty. I want for us this morning to have this desire. God, we want to see You. So please open our eyes to see You. But before we sing these songs, let's pray together. I want to lead you in prayer, and let's ask our Lord to open our hearts and open our eyes, because we want to see Him. We want to see Him working. We want to see His glory. So let's pray together. Father, we are here in Your presence, and we are Your children, and You are our God. So we want to see You this morning. We want to see You in Your splendor. We want to see Your majesty. We want to see Your glory and Your power. Father, we want to focus our eyes on You. We want to not be distracted by other things, but to fix our eyes on You. Lord, we want to praise You. And please, open our hearts this morning. Open our eyes so we can see You. We can see You in Your splendor. Bless You. Bless You, Lord. Let's sing together now. Holy, amazing grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace, 'twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious day that grace appeared, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy rains, an ending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy rains, an ending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy rains, an ending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine. Forever mine. We thank you, Jesus, that in your amazing grace we can see you this morning, and we can see your glory, we can see your power, and we can be filled with the power of your Holy Spirit, and we thank you for that. Amen. Amen. It's so great to be able to sing these lovely songs. And now we have for a song for our boys and girls. So are you ready? I hope you are ready. I hope you are ready to do the actions. And if you don't remember the actions, don't you worry. Just do whatever you want. Make your own actions, and you can do a dance and whatever you want to do. But sing this song. We will have the words on the screen. And by the way, if you don't have children in your house, don't be embarrassed to sing this song, because this song is about Jesus is the light of the world. So let's declare this: our Jesus is the light of the world. Let's sing together with our boys and girls this morning.
The world is searching for an answer, a ray of hope in a hole.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a joy to be with you here this morning. It's lovely to see these smiling faces. And in case you think I'm breaking COVID-19, I'm not, because along the front row, we have lots of smiling faces of little animals. I don't know which genius thought about it, but I love it because I hate preaching in an empty church. We're going to turn today to John chapter 9, one of the stories in the Bible that I absolutely love. John chapter 9, we'll be reading verses 1 to 11, 14, 17, and then 29 on to 38. So if you found John chapter 9, fourth book in the New Testament, it starts at verse 1. And now as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no man can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said these things, he spat on the ground and made clay with the saliva. And he anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay. And he said to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which is translated "sent." So he went and washed and came back seeing. Therefore the neighbors and those who previously had seen that he was blind said, Is not this he who sat and begged? Some said, "This is he." Others said, "It is like him." He said, "I am he." Therefore they said to him, "How were your eyes opened?" He answered and said, "A man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, 'Go to the pool of Siloam and wash.' So I went and washed and I received sight." Verse 14, "Now it was a Sabbath when Jesus made the clay and opened his eyes." Verse 17, They said to the blind man again, "What do you say about him, because he opened your eyes?" He said, "He is a prophet." Verse 29, "We know that God spoke to Moses," this is the Pharisee speaking, "as for this fellow, we do not know where he is from." The man answered and said to them, "Why, this is a marvelous thing, that you do not know where he is from, yet he has opened my eyes. Now we know that God does not hear sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, he hears him. Since the world began, it has been unheard of that anyone opened the eyes of one who was born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered and said to him, "You were completely born in sins, and you are teaching us." And they cast him out. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and when he had found him, he said to him, "Do you believe in the Son of God?" He answered and said, "Who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him?" And Jesus said to him, "You have both seen him, and it is he who is talking with you." And then he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshipped him. Like I said, this is a tremendous story, one that I have loved for as long as I've been able to read. We're going to look at a theme today called Delivered from Darkness. There are many people in the world today who are struggling with guilt from the past, hopelessness regarding the present, and fears regarding the future. Whenever John wrote this gospel, he was actually a comparatively old man. He's not like the other disciples who have written many years earlier. He was the one who we know from the scriptures was the one who was closest to Jesus. And therefore, his book is totally different from all the other three gospels. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, for instance. Mark, of course, we know, was not a disciple, neither was Luke. But whenever the writings are compared, we find that John is different. They recount many of the miracles that Jesus performed. John leaves many things out. He actually includes only 7 of the miracles, and 5 of them are not recounted anywhere else at all. This miracle we're looking at today is the 6th one in the book of John. The key verse in the book of John is found in chapter 20 and verse 31, where he writes, "These things I write that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life in his name." That was the entire purpose of him writing this book, and the reason that this previously unrecorded miracle is here. So what happened? We find this story can be summarized quite simply under 3 little titles: the overlooked, speaking of the man who was born blind; the overbearing, speaking of the religious Pharisees; and the overwhelmed, this man who experienced the words of Jesus and the touch of Jesus and the transformation that Jesus could bring out in someone's life. First of all, we look at the overlooked, the condition of this man. I was just thinking during the week, in America, where 4 of our sons are living, I've been told that every 20 minutes, one person goes blind. This man that we are reading about had never seen. He was living in a world of darkness. He had never seen the light of day. He had never seen colors. He had never seen the beauty of nature. He had to beg on Jerusalem streets on a daily basis. He could hear, he could feel, he could smell, he could talk. He could sense the moods around the people, probably. He had probably also heard people blaming his loss of sight on the fact that some form of sin was involved in his family. Every day he was concerned with survival, dependent on help, depending on hands out. But pride was a luxury that this man simply couldn't afford. As Jesus and the disciples approach, they see this man. And we see these disciples believing similarly to Job's friends in the Old Testament. They believe that if you are sick, then there must be some kind of sin involved. And so they ask this question: did this man sin, or did his parents sin? Sounds maybe intellectual, but is rather relatively stupid. Because how could this man have sinned when he had been born blind? And that is often the case with some very smart aleck questions asked to make a fool of things that are going on, especially when God is involved. This man had suffered his entire life with this sickness. And then we see the concern of the Lord Jesus Christ, the concern of the Savior. He answers them, and he had known long before he met him that the day would come when he would meet this man. And so he says, no, it wasn't this man, and it wasn't his parents. This has been allowed to happen that the work of God should be revealed. He knew that this man one day was going to be a testimony to the glory of God. So we are told that Jesus spat on the ground. We are told that he made clay and that he anointed the man's eyes with the clay. Why did he do this? We know that Jesus operated many different ways to perform a healing. Sometimes he touched. Sometimes he spoke. One time he allowed his cloak to be touched. Another time he used spit. And one time he used spit on a man's tongue and then touched the man's ears and spoke. All of these things were different. And he's trying to show us that even though his methods vary, there's a reason for it. And Warren Wiersbe says that we will not concentrate on the manner of healing and miss the message behind the healing. Sometimes we are very quick to claim that our way is the best. But If it works for you, then praise the Lord. If it doesn't, then don't condemn others who operate differently, unless it's over something that is totally unscriptural. Jesus then told this man to go to the pool of Siloam. We're told that the pool of Siloam, this word means scent. Now, he's not talking about perfume. He's talking about, as the Father sent me, so send I you. And remember, this man is still blind. Jesus didn't give him a sat-nav. He said, just go to the pool of Siloam. And we are told that he went. Verse 11 gives us a beautiful little pressy. If you look at it, he said, Jesus told me to go, and I went. Isn't it wonderful? Or wouldn't it be great to be able to respond like this? That he said, go, and I went. We'll remember that little verse in Matthew 28 and 19, where Jesus said, go therefore and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded. And lo, I am with you always. The tremendous thing to know that Jesus has said, go, and simply to do it. The change in the man. This is absolutely tremendous. This is the whole demeanor of this man. After he was healed, he was different. When we meet Christ, that makes a difference. The book of Corinthians, chapter 5 and verse 17 says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things pass away and all things become new. I remember as a young man, just after I became a Christian, and I had not been a very nice person beforehand, one of my neighbors had detested me, literally. And many times after, when I was going around different areas, I found that this lady had gone around saying, thank God, Lyttle has become a Christian. And it actually made it so much easier for me to witness to those people about what Jesus had done for me. He makes a difference. This man, maybe not yet saved, but he was different because he had felt the touch of Jesus in his life. He was different in his appearance. He had no longer this blind, empty expression. There was a joy in having discovered life. He was different in his actions. He was no longer begging. He was better. Neighbors who had known him for years were asking, is this really him? Some said, it is him. Others said, it's like him. Why is this? Well, it's actually very simple. If you're seeing someone sitting at the side of the road or bending over, they're blind, they're begging, it's totally different from someone who is vibrant with health and excited about what the world has to offer us now, ready for any challenge. And he turned around and he said, I am he. Can you imagine him for the first time in his life? He's putting faces to the voices that he has known for years. He's putting color to things. Everything for him is new. It's the first time. A different attitude, a different aptitude. No longer existing, he was living. They asked him, how did this happen? Well, a man called Jesus made clay. He anointed my eyes. He said, go to the pool of Siloam. I received my sight. Where is he now? I don't know. And then we see the story changing. Instead of this man who has been overlooked all his life, we're going to look at some people that were very overbearing. We're going to look at the Pharisees. When the joyful neighbors brought him to them, they were so excited. And their reaction was something very similar to what we call in Ireland a lead balloon. It didn't work out at all like what they thought. They were not pleased because something had happened and they knew that it was the Sabbath. So how could there be good news if anything had happened on the Sabbath? The first priority, how did it happen? Were any Sabbath laws violated? There are some people like that. They're more in, how do you say, concerned with rules than actually with doing what is right. Protocol to them must always be observed. How did it happen? And this time the man doesn't even mention Jesus by name, probably because everyone knows they're talking about it. He said, he made clay for my eyes, I washed and now I see. You find it in verse 15 of this reading. And some of these Pharisees, they are instantaneous in their reaction. What do they say? This man is not of God. The fact that something so wonderful had happened meant absolutely nothing to them. To them, it was just a matter of someone had needed something, whether it's baking or whether it's clay. It's all wrong. You cannot do work like this on a Sabbath day. But then some of the other Pharisees said, but how can he do this then if he's a sinner? So there's division amongst them. So they turn around and they ask the healed man what he thought about this healer. For this man, there's no doubt in his mind at all. He said he is a prophet. What does that mean? It means he's from God and he's got a message from God. Well, for these Pharisees, that is something totally unacceptable. We can't have that at all. And they refused to believe that this man had ever been blind and demand to see his parents. Isn't it strange the reaction that people have to good news? I love the fact that this man turned around and with the limited knowledge he had about Jesus, he proclaimed what he knew. Are we willing, wherever we go, whatever we are doing, to proclaim what we know about him? To be able to tell people that he is the Savior. He changed my life. He healed me. He did so much for me. Are we willing to do that? If we look in our world today and we think of what Jesus said, that the fields were white unto harvest 2,000 years ago, what is it like when God looks down on us all this time later? The declining interest in mission is a sure sign that for many people in the church, they have lost their first love. It hurts me to think sometimes that up to 80% of all of our efforts are still being concentrated on 20% who have already been reached over and over. Untold millions of people are held today in bondage. They're in spiritual darkness, and many of us never give it a thought. There are millions today who are going to a lost eternity, and Jesus died for them. We need to change our attitude. We need to think on why Jesus saved us in the first place. These men demanded to see the parents. And then we come to something that's a little bit sad. I remember all my life, whenever I had my four sons growing up, we were many times in foreign fields. We were in dangerous situations. And I always told my boys, no matter what happened, whatever they were facing, do what was right, do what was necessary, and I would back them up. They never, ever had cause to doubt that that was the case. And I regarded it as part of my life's work to back my sons. But here we see the cowardice of these parents. His entire life, they had looked at him, they had watched, they had prayed probably, they had probably questioned why their son. Sometimes life is tough. It's not fair. And then Jesus comes. Now, we don't know what age the man was when this happened, but suddenly their son has started to see, and it's simply too incredible for words. But then as they face these Pharisees, their smile starts to slip. There's opposition. These Pharisees are not happy. These parents are being interrogated Nazi style. Is this your son? Yes. Was he born blind? Yes. How did it happen? And now their nervousness sees a way out. He is of age. Ask him. They didn't like the thoughts of being on the wrong side of these people. They didn't want to be excommunicated from the synagogue. It would mean they were outcasts in the entire city. As missionaries for many, many years, first in Austria and now in Greece and Macedonia, we see this fear many times of people being afraid to come to the Lord Jesus Christ because the recognized church in their area would not accept this message of salvation at all. Sometimes it costs to follow Jesus. If you had been there at this time, you would have known that Jesus had already made some of these people mad. He had just healed on the Sabbath. That's a no-no in their eyes. In John chapter 7, just a little bit before this, some of the officers had been sent by these Pharisees to arrest Jesus, and they came back empty-handed. And they said, there's never been a man who spoke like this man. Now, if you're going to a preacher, you don't tell him how wonderful other people are, because sometimes that is not the right thing to do. But they were not pleased at that, no doubt. Then he had forgiven a woman caught in the act of adultery. They had wanted to stone her to death. And Jesus spoke to them, and everyone retreated in guilt. Many people started to believe in him. And then he had accused them, the Pharisees, of being the children of the devil. You can find that in John 8:44. And then when they challenged him, are you greater than our father Abraham? Well, Jesus turned around and he said to him, before Abraham was, I am. And because he said this, they lifted stones to kill him, because they could recognize in the words that he said that he was claiming equality with God. Many people looking at it today would say, but he didn't say that he was God. He didn't need to. Those people in that day knew exactly what he said, and they knew exactly what he meant. They were going to kill him because of it. And then we see the condemnation of this man, or the condemnation of the Pharisees for this man and for Jesus. In fact, as we look at this, you actually see this man, he's probably the first real apologist that these Pharisees have ever heard of. He's making a defense for the Lord Jesus Christ. For faith, he didn't yet know what Christianity was. I make a joke and I say sometimes about him, he was the original Josh McDowell who wrote those incredible books, Evidence That Demands a Verdict. If you look at them, their harshness and then their haughtiness. Give God the glory. Jesus is a sinner. Tell the truth. We know that this man is a sinner. They're coming out with religious jargon, and their hearts are as cold as ice. This man, he may be not much of a theologian, but he seems to be gathering confidence. He says, sinner or not, I don't know, but what I do know is, once I was blind, but now I can see. You see, it didn't matter about the pressure or the phony arguments. He knew, and all of us know, that religious bigots don't want to face up to either evidence or logic. Their minds are made up. That's why it is very, very important to have a personal experience. I know the day I was born again. I know when he changed my life, when I came from darkness to light. And nothing that anyone can say will ever change that. Then they said to him again, how did he do it? What did he do to you? And he says to them, I've told you before. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to be his disciple also? I think there's a little bit of sarcasm here, but I love it. The way that he simply brings it round again to show how wonderful this man Jesus is. And then they look at him and they say, you're his disciple, but we are Moses' disciples. When did ever Moses give sight to a blind man? Yes, he did perform the plagues. Yes, he did open the Red Sea. But as this man faced the enemy, or these Pharisees, they said to him, we know that God spoke to Moses. We don't even know where this fellow is from. And now this man, who's just received a sight, he's really getting warmed up. He said, here's a marvelous thing. He's literally dripping with sarcasm. He opens the eyes of a man born blind, and you don't even know where he's from. We know that God doesn't listen to sinners, and God listens to those who worship and obey him. This has never been heard of before in the history of the entire world. If he were not from God, he could do nothing. They don't like this one bit. They turn around to him and they said, you are totally born in sin and you dare to lecture us. They were possibly still of this persuasion that if you're not completely physically healthy, sin had to be involved somewhere in your life. And the Bible says they threw him out. What does that mean? It means excommunication. In those days, there were three forms of excommunication. There was the first type, where for 30 days he dare not come back inside the synagogue. No one could come closer to him than 6 feet, 2 meters approximately. They didn't have COVID-19, so there's nothing new under the sun. This has been experienced before many, many times. Sometimes it could be excommunication for an indefinite time, and other times it would be for absolute expulsion for all time, no return. And so, as we look at, first of all, this man at the beginning, the overlooked, we've looked at the overbearing attitude of these Pharisees, and closing with this part, the overwhelmed. This man who has just experienced one of the most amazing things in his entire life, he can now see, but there's something absolutely attractive about him. There's something about everything he says and does that makes you want to listen more to what he's saying about himself. He's like a beggar that has landed in a banquet, only it's much better. What everyone else takes for granted all around him, he has just been given it, and he's appreciating it, and he's talking about it. He's overwhelmed. He's a bit like a new, vibrant, enthusiastic Christian amongst a group of tired, disappointed, hopeless ones. And how we need this kind of vibrant Christian witness in our midst to spur us on to other things. This man has never had much, but he has character. In spite of the pressure that's put on him, he refuses to cower. He refuses to conspire with them. He refuses to compromise. He refuses to condemn this man that has healed him. In the midst of a wonderful new world, he's facing opposition. Why are they acting like that? Why are they denouncing this healer? Why do they not know the answer to his questions? He knew Jesus' name. He didn't know how he had been healed. He didn't know why he had been healed. But consistently, his words, his logic, bring him along the path of explaining and realizing who Jesus really was. We find in verse 11 that he is a man called Jesus. Verse 13b, he is of God. Verse 17, he acknowledges he is a prophet. And as we are approaching now to verse 36, he calls him Lord. He's starting to realize who this Jesus is. He has been thrown out. He's been shamed. He's been ostracized. But we don't see much of inferiority complex about him. And we're told in verse 35 that when Jesus heard what they had done, he found him. And this is the first time this man actually sees Jesus. Do you remember that verse in Luke 19:10? It tells us that the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. That's still true today. The story in Matthew 18, verse 12, the shepherd leaves the 99 to find the one. You see, finding lost individuals is his priority. Suffering is one thing, and if you're healed from a dreaded disease, that is a wonderful thing. But you know, when you become a Christian, when you are saved, that is something that is infinitely better. And Jesus comes beside this man and says, do you believe in the Son of God? Personally, I believe that as soon as this man, Jesus, spoke to him, the man recognized him. Many blind people have acute hearing, and they have a way of linking all kinds of little tones and notes, and it's amazing what they can hear. He would have known that this was the one who had healed him. Step by step, he's been prepared, and now he's ready. And we can see that he's willing to trust whatever Jesus says 100%. He says, in answer to this question, do you believe in the Son of God? Who is he, Lord, that I may believe? And I see this man. He has been touched by power, but he has been won by love. Jesus answered, you have seen him, and he is talking to you. And we're told in verse 18 that he says, Lord, I believe. and he worshipped him. Not for what Jesus had done, but for who he was. And this is the wonderful thing, when Jesus takes an active part in your life. This man on this day had received physical sight and spiritual sight. If he had only received his sight, it would have been a temporary miracle. But he received an eternal miracle. It's strange, but as Jesus goes on to talk about the fact that he came into this world for judgment, that they that are blind might see, and that those who see may be made blind. Strange, but the Pharisees are listening. And as they listen to him, are they keeping tabs on the blind man? Are they keeping tabs on Jesus? They realize that Jesus is talking to them. And they say in verse 40, are we blind also? You often find religious people do this. They did not believe that Jesus would have tried to embarrass them in the midst of all of these other people who knew them. But Jesus is always more interested in our comfort or our character than our comfort. And if we need to be humbled, then that's exactly what he will do. He hates hypocrisy and he will expose it. He said, if you had admitted your need, you would not be sinners. But yes, you are blind because you have chosen blindness. This man made his choice and it cost him. He was thrown out. But they had refused the light and that cost them so much more. We never hear of this blind beggar again, but I have no doubt that he went on to make a special mark for God and for this Savior with whom he had such a special relationship. I want to close with a couple of questions. If you were arrested for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? When you're challenged regarding what Jesus means to you, are you willing to testify to him and for him? Or are you like Peter and you look for a way out? And if you're alone and temptation comes, does your behavior show that you're on Jesus' side or on Satan's? Just a little while ago, I was in a store in Greece, and a gentleman who had talked to me over a year ago, and he had stood to me at the side of the store, and he said, I'm a Christian too. And then I discovered all kinds of immoral things going on in his life. I met him again just before Christmas, and as we talked again, and I told him what God's word said, he looked at me and he admitted that between our worldviews, even though he still called himself a Christian, he said there's a whole Atlantic Ocean of difference between us. But this is what we've been called. We've been called to go and to tell the good news, and what a privilege it is. And I'm thrilled to be here today to say that Jesus is still bringing sight to those who are blind. Not only involved in healing, but in restoring lost souls to himself. This man found Jesus, his life was revolutionized. Today, whatever you're facing, he can do the same for you. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for being able to look at your word. We thank you that it's got a message for all time. We thank you that amongst those who are listening today and have hearts that are heavy, you have a message of comfort, that you long to reach out, you long to touch, you long to change, you long to heal, you long to restore, and you long to save. We pray, Lord, that you will help any in need today within the sound of this voice to come to you, to realize that the one who has come to seek and to save that which was lost is still at work today. Part us with your blessing, we pray, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from there.